and there we go. While I frantically scramble to make my warlock 2 levels up. The stream.
Yeah, that would help. Yeah, so I put up a campaign journal for you guys, but as I'm sure you guys remember, we were on our way to rescue the noble prince of the Vistani people under this group led by Stanimir, and the mists came around and surrounded you, and you discovered that this was a lot more than you had bargained for. In the morning, the mist has receded slightly, though it still hangs thick in the air near you, deeply restricting your usual range of sight. The day is cast to gray by thick, dark clouds overhead. Stanimir guides you westward, but something is strange. Though you know you should be south of Daggerford and running into the Sword Coast any moment, instead you find yourself riding the wagons along a pocked road deep in a twisted forest. The clumping of the wagons, the creak of the axles, the clop of the heavy hooves of the pinto drafts used by the Vistani seem almost monotonous, paradoxical to the tense sense of danger all around. Adding another layer to this heavy sense of wrongness, the Vistani jest and laugh occasionally, even as they traverse the sullen gray terrain. It seems that even the sun finds this place intimidating. You are continuing through the morning with the Vistani? How
absolutely
are you traveling?
But I assume we don't have any mounts, so we're just walking along the caravan?
Right. They don't have spare horses. If you wanted, you could ride in the wagons, but you would want to. You would be expected to take a turn handling the wagons. In exchange for riding, otherwise you can walk along with the caravan.
Rook will find a wagon he can ride with, preferably one with female company.
I think I'll walk, boss. The horses, they don't like me. And I don't like them either.
Alright, stay close by. We're not too sure of trustworthy these people are. He'll say that very close by to Jarvik.
Oh, it's not them that I'm worried about. It's what's out there.
Never be too cautious.
It's not exactly the most welcoming countryside.
And as you go on, are you keeping an eye out just on the road or into the woods, or what's your level of perception, I guess?
So I'd like for us to be moving at a slow pace while we're in the mist, but if everybody's pushing forward, I'll acquiesce.
Rook will keep his attention on the women that he's riding with.
If we're actively in the mist, then yeah, I'm gonna be. Charvik is gonna be very edgy.
Yeah, you're. There's sort of like a clearing in the mist that follows you, but you are closely surrounded by the mist on all sides at all times.
Yeah, we're keeping lookout.
That was a great effect. Okay. I wonder if we can duplicate it for the show.
I don't like it. It's another fine mess you've gotten me into.
Oh, quit your belly aching. You signed up for yourself.
Right, but you're not paying me enough for spooky mist.
Eh, it's just mist.
It's but a hurdle for a larger payday.
You keep saying that, but I've yet to see a heavy purse.
So we'll want to do perception rolls as we're keeping an eye out. mean, I was hoping someone would pass. There we go.
To the halfling.
Never underestimate the ability of the party to fail hard.
I know. I was just thinking, wow, they're going to walk right past. But anyways. Tonto and Kaelin notice the distant but unmistakable scent of death in the air, and a group of crows and ravens off one side of the path in the forest.
I'll say, this doesn't feel right. In fact, this feels very unnerving.
What is unnerving?
Just the air, it just feels... I don't know, I feel almost like a sense of death in the air. Anybody else feel that?
I think it's just the bad cooking. Too many spices.
Right. Okay. Well, I think that we should continue to be cautious. Just know that we might be stepping into something that we don't want to be, but I guess we've gone too late, or too far too late.
Oh, do we see these crows?
That is easy. If you know not to step in something, don't follow the horses from behind.
Yeah, probably as Kaelin is looking around and all nervous, yeah. You guys, probably the rest of you spot the crows.
Alright. We'll draw our attention to it. Does the caravan slow down a bit as we walk over towards it?
They'll continue on a little ways, but when they notice that you're not with them, they'll stop a little ways up the road from you.
I wouldn't wander off too far. Rook's going to say as he stays on the wagon and watches you guys approach.
What are the travelers' reactions to seeing these crows? Like, are they sitting there, like, ducking down, making signs of the cross, or are they just like, what are they doing? They're just birds.
The Vistani, as always, are mostly just chatting and laughing and telling stories to each other. They, if they're having a reaction, you can't tell what it is.
Okay. I don't know, boss. What do you want to do?
I'd like to take a closer look.
Alright, I'll be right behind you. Way behind you.
He'll take his shield off of his back and keep his staff ready. And walk cautiously over towards the birds.
The foul scent intensifies as you walk over and discover a human corpse half buried in the underbrush about 15 feet from the road. The young man appears to be a commoner. His muddy clothes are torn and raked with claw marks. Crows have obviously been at the body, surrounded by paw prints. Man has obviously been dead for several days. He holds a crumpled envelope in one hand.
Kelthrus will glance around just to make sure that there's no other threats in the area, and then bend down to take a look at the parchment.
What's that you got there?
It's a sealed envelope with a large B set into red wax in the seal.
Is there any kind of indication of where this man has come from? Any sigils, or markings?
None of that, other than the B on the envelope. He just looks like he might be a messenger of some sort, just a typical commoner that a person might hand a couple coins. But if someone wants to do a survival, what if you're in, right in the area, you could probably get a better idea, at least where he came from.
I'll walk over and see if I can see anything.
Yeah, boss, I'm pretty certain he's dead.
I would concur. Good eye, though.
Kaelin thinks maybe he was headed toward the east, back out of the area of Barovia.
How about the bee? Is that recognizable in any way?
You can roll history to see.
And I never learned to read.
Am I sure that's a bee?
It might be a bee. It might be a rune. It could be anything for all you know.
Right.
Hey, boss, if you hold it sideways, you know, it kind of looks like a large woman, you know?
Her infinity. All right, regardless, we'll just look around and see if there is anything else peculiar about this poor soul.
Nothing is particular. It's just another tragic incident that you've come across.
The most important question is yet to be asked. What's in his pockets?
You're welcome to find out, the poor sod. As unpriestly as he can, he just takes a step back and does not do last rites.
Charvik, without any kind of hesitation or reverence, has just walks straight up to the body and just starts checking his pockets, turns him over, checks his back pockets.
You find nothing in his pockets but four little copper discs with no imprint on them, just little pieces of copper. Like, they're coins, but they're strangely blank coins.
What do you make of these, boss? I don't think he's the type to be counterfeiting.
Perhaps this note would have shed a little more illumination upon this, as he said, as he creates a light spell on his staff and breaks open the seal upon the envelope.
Thank you, Lord.
And there is the letter that you...
Shall I? Hail thee of midnight and valor. I, the Burgomaster of Barovia, send you honor with despair. My adopted daughter, the fair Irina Kalnikov, or what is that?
Kalyana.
Gotcha. Has been these past nights bitten by a vampire. For over 400 years, this creature has drained the life blood of many people. How my dear Irina languishes and dies from an unholy wound caused by this vile beast. He has become too powerful to conquer. So I say to you, give us up for dead and incite this land. Is that incite? Or encircle? This land with the symbols of good. Let holy men call upon their power, that the devil may be contained within the walls of weeping Barovia. Leave our sorrows to our graves, and save the world from this evil fate of ours. There is much wealth untrapped in this community. Return for your reward after we are all departed for a better life. What is that?
Kolyan Indirovich, Burgomaster. Yeah.
Okay. Excellent penmanship, I might say.
So they said about wealth.
What was that?
Glad you're paying attention to something.
What was that he said about daughters?
Well, this vampire seems to be a beast, very powerful.
Yeah, see, that's the part that's got me worried. Vampire.
Yeah, there are some things that go bump in the night that you don't actually want to find out. That would be one of them. You sure you want to be getting involved with this, boss?
I believe this has become our fight.
Yeah, I was afraid you would say that. Yeah, well, you only live once or twice.
Rook's going to ask of one of the people that he's been riding next to that Bavoria don't happen to be in the other direction, does it?
They'll give him a funny look and gesture toward the west in the direction they're going and say, "We are headed to Barovia."
Oh, that's what I was afraid you'd say.
The same.
Why word. Ask?
Where there is much wealth entrapped in it. As he points to this section of the letter for Rook. Besides,
I'm just gonna kinda sigh.
And as you're all discussing this from deeper in the woods, you hear a single whistle.
I don't like the sound of that, boss. Maybe we should be get going, yeah?
Yes. Let's get with the others. Keep your eye out, though. We'll ask Stanimir if he knows of this Burgomaster.
Stanimir nods and says he's a well-respected man, the Burgomaster of the village of Barovia, which will be the first village which we encounter. We have to go through there to seek Madam Eva's counsel.
Very good. Let us continue. Jarvik and Ponto and Kaelin and Rook, I say we should hang in the back to protect the caravan, just in case we are besieged by those howling creatures.
I'm comfortable right where I am.
Suit yourself.
Just don't forget, if push comes to shove, I don't think the ladies will be too impressed if you're hiding amongst the wagons. Just thought I'd mention.
I'm just making myself comfortable. He's gonna pat the leg of one of the women he's sitting next to.
That's alright. We can protect Rook and the women.
Hey now, I didn't say I needed your protection.
Be comfortable, friend. We can handle it.
Right, figured you was in good hands.
Indeed.
Just give me a shout if you find yourself in trouble.
We may save you some.
Charvik is going to find himself on the wagons towards the middle of the caravan and hop up on the page boy's post on the back.
Alright, easily done.
Get some elevation.
Checking out the front or the back? Or just turning about?
Just scanning ahead, you know, point of view.
Alright. And is that how you guys set off?
Yeah, Kethris will be in the back.
Kaelin will be in the back too, probably nearby Kethris.
Alright. And how about Ponto? Hunter with us?
Is he muted?
Yeah, we haven't heard Jason all night. He might be muted.
Yeah.
Jason?
He's made some rolls, right? Yeah, he's here. Okay.
I'm not seeing the usual Skype, you know, little border blip thing when someone's speaking, so either muted or mic's not working.
Alright. Well, if you're hearing us, you're muted otherwise, or not working otherwise, maybe he stepped away or something? Either way, let's assume he's in the back.
Okay.
And that's how you guys set off. And, it's just a pretty comfortable trip as you set out across this road. The Vistani are cheerful companions. And you go on this way how long will you go on this way before you guys request to stop for any amount of time?
Until we've traveled like a full day of 8 hours, and then ask for a camp.
All right. Well, after about 2 hours of travel, where was that? Okay, after about two. Oh, go ahead.
Am I coming in now?
Yeah. Yes.
Right. There he is.
Okay, my son would messed around the microphone plugs.
No.
So I'm here. I'm sorry.
It's okay, we were just like, yeah.
I heard everything, and yeah, I'm just going to be hanging out in the back wagon, so.
Alright. Okay, so then it's Charvik who notices first that up ahead, through the chill mist, a man dressed in furs and leather steps forward. Shaggy hair and thick mutton chops frame his face. The blade of his wood axe glints brightly as he hefts it onto his shoulder and greets the caravan with a deep, "Ho there, travelers!"
Just in case that's not fully audible to everyone else, Charvik will just yell back to the rear, "Hi, boss! It's got company!"
Alright, Kelthrus will make his way up towards the front, looking out for Stanimir. See what he's going to do as well.
Stanimir stops his Vistani and kind of gestures you forward, hoping that you'll see what that's about.
Alright. Kelthrus will go up to the front. He'll give Charvik a look as if he could use your help.
Prearranged signal. Charvik nods and moves to the opposite side of the wagons. Well in sight of both his boss and the gentleman on the road.
Alright, we'll stand in front of the caravan. And you are, sir?
Well, woodsman will walk up and introduce himself. Name's Brian. Been working in the woods. You know there's werewolves out here, right?
I was not made aware, but thank you for the warning, Brian.
He's gonna glance off to the left and to the right, and then he's gonna say, "You need to make sure you've got some silvered weapons. Do you have any with you?"
Are you offering to sell some of yours?
He's gonna shake his head. And he's gonna pull the blade off of the... One second. Sorry. He's gonna pull the blade off of his shoulder, the axe off of his shoulder, and show it to you how the blade is silvered and say, "Just offering friendly advice, this is the only one I've got. But you want to get some quick before you find yourselves... well, snacks."
You're an especially brave woodsman for doing your job around these werewolves. How many have you seen?
Out in the forest by yourself, in the mist, at night.
It's the middle of the day. He's gonna shake his head a little and say, never seen him myself, just heard about him. I don't like to see strangers taken advantage of, and then he's gonna shoot the Bastani a look.
Can we determine if he is full of it, or if he's like actually shows that he has like some kind of experience or green around the collar?
You get the sense that there is definitely more motivation than just friendly concern, certainly.
I think we'll be alright. What do you think, boss, eh? I think we can handle a few little puppies.
I think Brian here is very kind to offer his suggestions, and it was very, very nice to meet you. And we will take it under consideration. How far to the next town?
Well, you've got about 4 miles left to travel, and he definitely sounds a lot less, both less outgoing and more, a little disappointed, almost.
Have I said something to offend you, kind sir?
Not at all, not at all. You got about 4 miles before you're done, if you're headed to town, town of Barovia.
Is there anything we could do for you in exchange?
Not at all, not at all. He's going to seem almost like he's now suddenly very cautious of you, since you've caught on that he's, since you're not following, doing whatever it is that he wants, he seems very cautious of you.
I think we've got some salt in the cart if you want to throw it over your shoulder, or maybe find you a mirror or lucky horseshoe. That might be more effective, I think.
He kind of gives you a blank look and tilts his head puzzledly and says, "What?"
Nothing, nothing. Just superstition. I'll take a good handful of fire any day. And Charvik will snap his fingers and a small ball of flame will briefly appear in the cup of his hand. Before dismissing with a curl of smoke.
And with that, he's going to kind of nod to you and wish you well and try to pass the caravan heading eastward. Like, carry on his way.
I don't know about you, boss, but these people are really superstitious.
Well, it is an odd environment. To be living your whole life in this mist surely can't make you a normal person, as I would expect us to be basically well, enough of that anyway.
Is there anything that Rook might have learned from any small talk he may be having with the people that he's riding with?
Absolutely. Are you talking about anything in particular, or are you just generally making conversation?
He'll probably try to make it like he's making conversation, but he'll probably be trying to find out some information about Barovia, the town they're heading into particularly. Asking about vampires and such, and maybe what kind of valuables they have.
The important things to be asking, right. Really.
Yeah, got his priorities in order, for sure.
It's like, yeah, I heard about you know that. I picked up the Fromers, and I heard they're a really rich town, too. What do you think about that?
Okay. Well, they pretty much completely avoid the subject of vampires.
Okay.
They're very deft conversationalists, and they'll always either laugh it off or make a segue to something else. As far as the village of Barovia, there's not much that they can tell you. It's a small village. It's the sort of the inlet to most people coming into Barovia when people come into Barovia. You know that it is a very superstitious, the land of Barovia is a very superstitious people, and that the actual Barovians are even more superstitious than the Vistani. You do pick up the rumor that they say that the souls of people who die in Barovia can never escape to the afterlife. They are prisoners in the realm of Barovia. And then they'll shrug and kind of laugh and say, of course, that could just be superstition.
Right, superstition. What kind of wealth are we talking about here?
Well, the village is mostly very poor. Most of the commoners are very poor. But the nobles, like the burgomasters of the villages, or, you know, a few individuals, will have quite a bit of wealth. And of course, and they're going to kind of look to the side and say, there are untold riches at the castle.
Castle? Who's living up there?
Nobody lives there. We take turns. Sorry. Couldn't help
it. This is a silly place.
That was good.
Yeah, that was brilliant. They're going to kind of give him a blank stare and then just say, about that, you should speak to Madame Eva.
Alright. I suppose if that's the direction we're heading.
Yeah, only 4 miles to go. Let's get moving, probably.
And as you head on, you just continue as usual. Stanimir is appreciative of you handling the man on the road. But you do notice that the occasional distant howling of wolves seems to be getting closer. And
Rook's going to fidget a little bit and then ask the women that he's traveling with or whoever is sitting next to him. It's like, you don't happen to have any of them silvered weapons that folk on the road was talking about, do you?
And the young Vistani woman sitting next to Rook will say, ah, that's a legend. There are no werewolves out here. She does sound quite certain of herself, but she's a young adult, so she would be even if she didn't know what she was talking about.
He's going to kind of nod and look around a little uncomfortably.
Keep a sharp eye, as wolves could be just as dangerous.
And after about half an hour of traveling with the ever closer calling of the wolves, Stanimir stops and calls for you all to come to the head of the caravan.
All right, we rush up there.
Rook will reluctantly leave his wagon and follow behind the rest of them.
Perfect takes his time and saunters up.
Stanimir will point up ahead to a place further up the road and say, they don't usually come into the road, but They're blocking our way. And you can see vaguely a few figures in the mist across the road, a good 50 feet out ahead of you, ahead of the start of the caravan.
What? Who's that?
Are these humanoid figures?
No, they're four-legged and low to the ground.
Looks like the wolves found us. Not like we're being that quiet either.
Can we get a sense of how many there are?
Yeah, as far as you can see, there are five up ahead through the mists. As to whether there are others or not, that you're not able to tell.
Well, good luck to you, and Brooke's going to start backing up toward the wagon slowly.
Let's head into formation. Brooke, we'll need you.
You know I'm not much of the scrappy type, right?
Well, there's no time like the present to learn. And Charvik will pull out a dagger from his boot and slap it into his hand.
He's gonna kind of look at the dagger like he didn't know what to do with it for a minute and say, "You sure you don't want me to watch the wagons?"
Don't be silly. That's what the caravan is for. They can handle themselves.
Yeah, at that, Kelthrus will tell Stanimir, stay with the wagons and yell if anything happens to the wagons or anyone in the caravan. We're going to head over to take care of this.
Stanimir nods once in understanding as you guys head out to engage the wolves.
If there's opportunity to do so, Charvik will walk up to Kelthrus and briefly tap him on the shoulder as a surge of protective energy will flow into him.
Absolutely. I mean, the wolves aren't approaching, so you guys can engage them at your and feel free to arrange yourselves however you'd be approaching, obviously.
Is there any place that Rook could hide as the other is, like, along the road here? Slip away unnoticed?
Certainly there's the trees and underbrush on the side of the road.
As the others approach, he's going to kind of move slowly until he's kind of like, they're all past him. Provided they pass him, and then he's going to try to slip into the undergrowth and hide here.
All right.
And
all right, Kelthrus will take out his shield. He will call forth the power of nature and cast Shillelagh on his staff. And he will step up with Ponto.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to pull out my nunchucks. And give a nod to... Still trying to learn names. Kelthrus, and said... ready when you are.
Let's see if we can disperse them first.
Oh, I should probably turn on the turn now. Alright, if everyone wants... Hey, off that. If anybody wants to roll initiatives, that would be great.
Selected.
Yeah. I haven't seen these initiative buttons on here. Is it just dex, or is there an initiative button? Oh, never mind. Here it is.
Yeah, next armor class.
On this sheet, all the words are your buttons. I'm still sitting here trying to figure out spells, but it's all good.
Does anyone happen to know if there's an easy way to roll initiative for an NPC sheet?
If you click on its name, I think that does it.
That's amazing. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the funny thing is, I rolled initiative, but it didn't come through on the tracker.
Did you have your token selected when you did it?
No. Okay, then let's try this again.
Alright, and I will fix...
Because... I don't actually have an initiative button.
It's the actual word initiative on your sheet.
Yeah, that's weird how it's still not...
And you can drag that down to the left if you have the macro bar open. Because you're going to use it a lot.
Yeah.
And since it's not automatically putting him, how would I go about adding him to turn order?
It's weird, unless I did.
Oh, right click on his token, and then add turn.
Okay. Okay. Aaron is first to act.
Yeah, I should have read all my spells before we started playing tonight. So I'm trying to go through and figure out what it is I would do right now.
We got spoiled by the first session. It was all RP.
Yeah, right, exactly.
That's okay. I still haven't read all of my spells for the character that from our other campaign that I've been playing since, what was it, January? So... You're probably still way ahead of me.
Okay. I'm going to use my Thunder Wave in hopes that maybe they'll disperse. I'm going to aim it. Oh, wait. Where's my ping? Here. That should get them all.
I think Thunder Wave's a close spell, isn't it?
It is. It bursts from yourself.
Oh, is it close? Oh. See, what did I say? I didn't read it close enough.
But you could get us.
I mean, you could
get you.
Totally run right up into the middle of them, if you want to.
I'm okay with either of those options.
That's true. Wait, what is my speed? Oh, I need to learn my character. What am I doing? Okay.
Everyone moves 6 squares, 30 feet, unless you're like a dwarf or halfling or something.
The monk?
Ugh, cancel. Sorry.
Do you remember my first monk, Mike?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that was abusive.
Okay, so then I'll run here and do that spell. So I'll run up to them, and it'll radiate 15 feet out from me, so I guess it does get them all. Still. But it should, yeah, it avoids Ponto and Keyless.
It's in a direction, I believe. So you just pick one corner of
your character okay.
And you place
a
15-foot square.
Oh, okay. I thought it was like a radius. Okay, I misunderstood
so
that description.
Those three, these two, however you wanna.
Yeah, go up. Yeah, there. I'll do those three. That'll work.
Oh.
And hopefully...
Okay, so those Those puppies need constitution saves. As the druid furiously runs up and smacks the ground with a shockwave of force.
Isn't it centered on you, a 15-foot cube?
That's what I thought! Let me double check, mistaken.
My knowledge of a lot of these spells come from...
Thunderswave, 15-foot cube, yeah. So it was 15-foot, then out. Like...
Each creature in a 15 cube originating from you. Okay, so it is a large thing.
But is it a 15-foot, like, radius? See, that's confusing.
Well, the cube, it says in the book that the cubes, if it's a cube, the point of origin can lie anywhere on a face. So it does still have to be in, like, a direction, doesn't it?
Mm.
Because you'd still have to be on the edge for it to be a point on the page.
So I'm just remembering how cubes worked in 4th edition. And that was just pick a corner, and that's where it emanates from.
Just point of orange, your size, and your
Well, we can just hand... Well, we can just hand wave it for now, and we can figure it out later.
Yeah. Good idea.
So how would the GM like it to work?
I'm interpreting it as the 15 in a direction, and you have to be on one side of it. So the 3 would work well, I think. Just based on my interpretation.
So would I have to be in the center, or what are you... Maybe I'm not understanding.
No, that's fine how you had it before.
Okay.
And any point, you can be at any point on the face of the cube, so...
I don't have to be in the center of the cube. Okay.
No, not at all. And
okay.
So one little doggy took 14, and two little doggies took 7. And this little doggy was pushed back 10 feet, right?
Yep.
Go like that? Alright.
That's what I would... Yeah. That's what I would guess.
Okay. And did you want to do anything else, or is that your turn?
That's a bad dog.
Yeah, right, yeah. Saying that, get out of here, get. That'll be it.
All right, I remember that. Charvet.
Alrighty. Charvet will step to the side here, and a dark gleam of fire will appear in the back of his eyes, kind of like a bad photograph, and two eldritch black flames will appear in his hands, and he will arc a beam downstream down to this guide.
Right.
As soon as I find my spell to make that actually happen.
That actually misses.
Sad.
Huh. What is the warranty on these things? He shakes his hand.
All right. Ponto.
Yeah. Kind of move up to here to protect a druid friend. And we'll try that. That's going to miss also.
Yes.
These are tough puppies.
That'll be all of my turn for now.
Okay. Mm-hmm. This upper one who was not concerned or not addressed by Kaelin's attack is going to charge forward and attempt to bite a Skeletris, right?
Yep. So unless they have advantage, that is a miss, thankfully.
They do not. Yes. And since this one has just been lashed out at by the monk, he is going to angrily snap his jaws at Ponto.
Ouch.
Does he get two bite attacks? Oh no, that was the first one. That's right.
Right.
I thought Ponto got bit twice. I was like, what?
Unfortunately, they do not get two. And let's see. This one's going to be 50-50 whether Kaylin's minor damage distracted it from its initial fixation on Ponto and Kelfris. So it'll be a D3 for Kaylin, Ponto, and Kelfris. Kelfris is the lucky winner.
Yay! Yay.
And unfortunately now it does get advantage because these little buggers have pack tactics.
Oh yeah. That's fun stuff. That is a definite hit.
Any chance that these creatures are aberrations, fae, fiends, or undead?
They're just beasts.
Okay.
So
evil doesn't help you.
Oh, is that what that shield is?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And number four here will make the same decision as far as who to attack with Kaylin, Ponto, Kelfris. Lucky winner.
Kaylin. Yay. Yeah, that hits.
Probably.
For sure.
And naturally, this puppy is especially angry at Kaylin. He goes straight for her, and he'll have advantage as well.
Oh, this is good.
Oh dear.
Ouch.
Yeah.
So I am out. Goodbye.
TPK Megs on your first one. Nice.
Oh my god.
They grow up so quickly.
We got this. Rookle says.
Yep, it's on the roof now.
with the dagger that Char gave him, he's going to throw it at that wolf. Oh wait, that one hasn't been damaged yet, right?
None of the two near me have.
Oh, okay.
Or no, actually they have.
I thought one of them had gotten hit, right?
This is the most damaged one right here.
One of the ones, the bottom one, this one is unharmed. This one was harmed by Kaylin's attack.
Okay. I'm going to throw my dagger I got from Char at that one, the one that's been damaged. And then do I get sneak attack on that attack?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Anytime so here's your friends are adjacent.
Yeah, alright. So here's the dagger. And the 22 hits.
Oh, definitely.
That's the regular damage. And that should be the sneak attack damage.
Alright. A loud yelp comes from the obviously wounded direwolf.
And then I'm going to move. To here, but I'm going to try to do it sneakily. So do you want a stealth roll?
Moving through the tree line?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's perfect. Okay. You... I'll roll their perception and see if you hide from them. Yeah, they're really fixated on their prey right now, and you are easily able to evade their notice. As it moves to Calthrus.
Alright, a bit worried that a wolf is gnawing on his leg. He grips the holy symbol around his neck, and he whispers quiet prayer. And then a radiant wave shoots out from him and causes radiance of the dawn.
Nice. Okay. They are... The good news is all of the wolves are... well, here. 14, DC 14?
Yep.
Okay. This one failed. And this one failed.
This is definitely the runt of the litter.
Right?
Can I tell how bad Kaylin is?
I mean, I'm out. I'm on the ground.
Okay.
I'm down. I am at zero.
Alright. So, at that moment, he'll do a bonus action and whisper a healing word to Kaylin. So, using a second level spell, she'll heal 6 points.
Ooh. I'll wake up and shake it off and be very confused as to what just happened.
Okay, and I don't really want a attack opportunity, but I think I'm gonna have to just stay that way.
Alright, so that's it?
Yep.
Okay, and it's back to Kaylin.
So I'm mad. And I will use my wild shape and change into a bear, I think. Because I feel like a bear could take on these wolves. Wild shape's a bonus action, right? I think
it's a standard.
Or is it standard?
Let's find out.
Are you guys making me learn the rules of this game?
I know.
Well, see, this is where you can let your players take care of that.
Oh, I can revert to my human form as a bonus action, I think.
That sounds about right.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can use your action. Yeah, so I can use my action to change into a bear, but then a bonus action. So, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to change into a bear and probably stay there, stay on my ground. Or, yeah, no, I'll just stay there. That's what I'll do. As a bear. And I guess since that's a full action, that's all I will do.
As a bear. Let me give you a bear.
Oh! Oh!
Are you large or medium? Are you large or medium as a bear?
It says large brown bear, large beast is what I'm looking at.
Okay. All right. Oh god, that's
hard. Oh my god.
Largest 2x2.
Yep, you can stretch it. You can make them wider. It's not that hungry.
There we go.
So do I kick the wolves and Ponto out of the way when I change?
Yeah.
I think you shift back to whatever the free space is.
Okay.
Yeah.
So because you took...
Your token in the corner for token actions.
You're Circle of the Moon, right?
I am Circle of the Moon, yes.
So you get Combat Wild Shape as an ability, which says you gain the ability to use your Wild Shape on your turn as a bonus action rather than as an action.
Oh, I wasn't reading in that section.
Yeah.
So it is a bonus action? That's why I thought it was, because I think I read it, 2 weeks ago?
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, okay, cool. So then I can still attack.
Yes.
Absolutely.
So then I'll attack this one, because this is the one that knocked me out. Mad at you. Rawr. And I will bite. D20 plus 4. Oh, that probably misses.
Yeah, that misses.
But it'll also squirt.
Very, very, very ferocious miss, though.
Yeah. Snarl. And then I get to scratch him as well with claws, which would also be, I assume, strength. Oh, maybe that hits.
Oh, that hits.
Okay, 2... D6 plus 4... And there's the damage. Whoa!
Whoa!
Yeah!
Which one? Winnie the Pooh will fuck you up.
Yeah, that wolf is not doing well at all.
I'm honestly surprised it's still alive.
Yeah. Me too. Wait, let me check my math. No, it's still alive. It's hanging in there. Somehow.
So that's my turn. I'll just stay there.
And Charvik.
Don't worry, boss. I'm coming.
Better make it quick.
Alright, we're going to cast on this guy. As a bonus action. Hex. There's no save. It just happens.
Ooh.
And he's hopefully going to get an Eldritch Blast to the face.
Indeed he is.
That will also push him back 10 feet.
Ooh. Nicely done.
Oh, I have to roll the actual. That's the extra damage. Yay. More food for the bear.
And Ponto.
Well, we're gonna try this again. The one straight in front of me.
And that hits.
And since I'm pretty well surrounded, I think I'm gonna spend a key point and get 2 extra attacks. Now these are unarmed attacks, right?
Yes.
Awesome. I don't have one set up for that. But it would pretty much be the same. So I'm going to use that for right now.
Okay, the first misses, but the second hits. Unless for some reason you have advantage on the second.
Nope. Not that I'm aware of.
Alright, and you're still on that one right in front of you?
Yes.
Okay, he too is on his last pause. Now the wolves get a chance to turn this around. This one is still going to focus on Kelpins.
Shoo, miss.
And since Kelpins seems to be in the way of any line of sight to, or line of attack to Charvik, this guy is going to take it down on Kelpus.
Both of those miss.
Even with the advantage on the second one?
Oh, yeah, I have 18 AC.
Oh, nice. Okay. This one's a little pissed off that it got its prey turned into a predator, so it's going to attack Kaelin.
That, what's, the, oh yeah, that hits the bear. Yeah, because I take the bear's AC, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Great, okay.
Fortunately, I believe you also take the bear's hit points, so.
Yep. Yes, I do.
And then these last two are going to try and deal with this man wildly swinging his fists at them, or is... And fortunately, pretty bad at it. Was that 14 here, Ponto?
No.
All right.
Sweet.
And we move on to the rook.
You might be muted.
Yeah, we've never heard Rook this quiet.
Yeah. your token is moving, but we're not hearing anything. Seems like we're having mic issues tonight everywhere.
It's all Mike's fault.
That's true.
Hold on, I have a cat.
He's not in here bothering me. He's probably in there bothering him, so...
Can you guys hear me now?
There you go.
Okay. Yes. Sorry, I think he unplugged my mic or something. Stop it. Okay, so he's going to run forward with his short sword drawn and stab at this wolf. And he still gets sneak attack, I think, because somebody's adjacent. And then I'm going to take my cunning action to disengage and move out of the way. So I moved.
Well, you don't even need to use your cunning action because that wolf did.
Oh, okay. Then I'm going to move away into... Then I'm actually going to move this way and use my cunning action to hide again.
Yeah, that probably works.
It's very cunning.
That's higher than they're even capable of rolling, so congratulations, yeah, right.
You outsmarted them.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Kalthras.
Alright, let's see if we can get rid of one of these wolves. Do either of these look worse off than the other?
Yeah, this one... Wait, which one's which? This one right here.
Alright, I'll go after him.
That's for where. Okay.
Going to try to crack him on the head with this staff here.
And you are successful.
Oh, I don't have damage filled in. Why is that?
Staffs are D8, I believe. D6, excuse me.
Yeah, with Shillelagh, it's D8 plus my Wiz modifier, but it's, I have it filled out here, but it doesn't seem to be working.
There's an option in there on the gear icon of your overall sheet to roll damage with it.
You can also click on quarterstaff down there. On the word quarterstaff, there you go.
Ah, cool.
Nice. And fortunately that is exactly what you needed.
Wow, these things are tough.
Yeah. And my fiancé, I let him roll the numbers for your encounter. All right.
I'll take a step here and intercede between Charvik and the wolf. Finish.
All right. And then we're back to Kaelin.
I will try to finish this guy off.
Okay.
And what was... D20+4, yes. So there's the bite attack.
Easily strikes.
Okay, and what is... That's 1d8+4. And there's the damage.
Okay.
And then I will claw at the wolf as well, if it's still standing.
It is.
Guessing that also hits.
Oh, yeah.
And scratch at it a couple times, and hopefully...
Yes, congratulations! You have found another wolf.
Yes.
Make a little claw post.
Just gotta sharpen those claws, you know.
Right. Okay, and is that all?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I'll move in. Well, I'll maybe move here to get closer to this guy.
Okay.
In case Ponto doesn't finish him off.
Jarvik.
Step right up. Everyone is a winner. Hit the target and win a QP. So, 11 damage altogether.
Okay.
And if he's still alive, shove him back 10 feet.
He is as close to dead as there's possible to be without being dead, but he's not dead.
He's undead.
He's very angry, though, for what that's worth.
The bear and looked Ponto. Hungry. Here's another snack.
Yep. And actually, as a bonus action, I get an unarmed strike for free.
Okay.
And that does just nothing but swinging at him. But
okay. Nope. All right. This guy has joined his neighbors on the ground.
Sweet.
And seeing his pack reduced to nothing, this wolf takes off.
I'll roar after him as he runs. Like, get back here. Rawr.
Does anyone want to give chase if you let him escape?
I definitely want to have some target practice.
Yeah, if we can get within range to do an attack, we might be able to do that.
Okay. Then we're back to the rook.
He's just going to slip back towards the wagons.
Never mind, I don't care.
You mean run?
No, he's just, you know.
No, I mean, like,
chasing after something.
The wolf is running away, so why, why bother attack it? The wolf obviously doesn't want to have anything to do with us.
No, I meant, like, you expect me to run? What?
Oh, right, yeah. So he's just quietly gonna, like, slip back through the forest and make his way back to the wagon, where he knows there is women and wine.
Alright, once again, Rook has fantastic priorities. Kelthras.
Alright, Kelthras will step up and send a sacred flame down upon him.
What color is that flame?
It is whitish blue.
And it is enough.
Nice.
The rope drops.
Good job, boss.
We couldn't have a lone wolf getting away from us.
Well, looks like we'll be eating pretty well tonight. And look, more skins. I bet these will fetch a pretty penny in town.
They were acting very peculiar. Kaelin, have you ever seen wolves do such a thing? As if they were guarding the road.
I'm still in bear form right now, so I probably can't talk to you.
You turn around and just like...
Shake your head once for yes, two for no.
With a mouthful of wolf meat, you know? I don't know, have I? Should I roll something, or have I seen wolves?
Probably nature.
I guess roll nature?
Okay. Yeah. Probably not.
You definitely haven't seen wolves do that. Apparently you haven't seen wolves do much.
Yeah.
But that is not among
I'm
the
I'm super excited that I finally met a wolf.
I've heard of those.
I love the way you guys roll.
Failure is always an option.
Yeah,
it's apparently more, it's they're more not fun. Terrible.
That's true. These are just, I mean, we knew these were just to be wolves, right? Nothing like...
Even with nature rolls at that, you guys are aware of the lore that a werewolf would return to human form on death.
Gotcha.
So you're pretty sure that they are, in fact, wolves.
I'm pretty sure werewolves are just big furry men on 2 feet.
Right, so are we going to wait out here for more of them to show up? Because I'd like to get back to the wagons and get to town.
Yeah, we'll ask the Vistani if they have any use for the pelts, the wolves, and maybe the meat.
Well, they're more than happy to have the meat as for their stews and whatnot. They'll take pretty much any meat that's good for eating, and wolf meat is among those kinds of meat. The pelts, they might be willing to trade with you for, but they feel that the pelts are yours. So they would need to find a price. They wouldn't really want to just...
Well, they'll take any meat to get their hands on. Hey, Rook, you might have a chance after all.
He's going to flip you off. And walk back to the wagons.
I'll pick up one of the wolves with my mouth and sort of... Or maybe I can carry more than one? I don't know, but I'll drag one.
I'm just picturing this 10x10 large bear... Just doing that little happy prance that cats do.
That's when exactly,
they catch the
yeah.
Back to home.
That's pretty much how she feels right now.
Could we almost use her as a pack mule and toss a few up on her back? Or would they be too?
If she doesn't murder you for that, absolutely.
I was gonna say, I don't know how. I mean, I have a strength of 19, but I don't know what that means in regards to the wolf's weight.
Yeah, we could put a 19 strength could easily carry all that.
Okay.
And us too.
Well, wait now. If anybody tries to pop on my back, I will snarl. You can put the wolves up there, but.
When Rook gets close to Standomir, he's going to pull him inside and say, "Alright, look, we've done your dirty work here. How much are these pelts worth to you?"
Priorities.
And there's some meat, good meat on that wolf.
Stanimir will kind of fold his arms and think for a minute. And then he'll go over to a drawer in the side of his wagon and pull out a small satchel of gemstones, and they're, like a topaz, the brown topaz stones, and there are 6 of them about the size of a robin's egg. And he'll show those to you and say, we'll gladly barter these with you for those, for the wolves.
All 6?
He'll nod his head and say, 1 for each pelt and 1 for the meat.
Alright, sounds like a deal.
Thanks, if you'd be so kind as to create a handout for...
I was just about to, I'd say. I should have done that earlier.
When the rest of the party comes back, he's going to give each person a topaz and keep 2 for himself.
So I guess you ran ahead of everybody while we slowly...
Yeah, well, you guys are dealing with the wolves. He's okay. Been negotiating payment.
I didn't realize that.
So when you guys come, he'll say, all right, they've bought the pelts and the meat. And he's going to hold out his hand. And there are going to be 4 topazes, or 5 topazes in it when he holds it out. And he'd be like, he takes his cut. So he'll take 1 for himself and present the other 4 to you guys.
It's not skimming, it's a handling fee.
Well, you mean 1 topaz for each of us, right?
Right, 5 topazes for the pelts and the meat. We each
can
get 1.
Can anybody see through his... I mean, I'm a bear, but I'm just curious, like, can anybody see through his bullshit?
I don't know.
Yeah, you can all roll insight against his deception.
I don't know where you've done your maths, but there are 6 of us in 6 topazes.
There's not 6 of us, there's 5 of us. Can you not count? Do they not teach you to count in the 9 hills?
I'm pretty sure.
There's me.
He's completely not sure. I'm pretty sure.
There's me, there's the monk, there's Kel, there's you, and there's the druid. That's 5.
No. That's 1 plus 2 plus 1 plus 1. I'm saying there's 2 plus 1 plus 2 plus 1.
Even as a bear, I'm just shaking my head.
If you don't want the topaz, I'll keep it.
And we'll just continue this conversation as the caravan keeps going, arguing this for the next half hour to an hour.
No. You do not see. It is...
If you're really arguing that long, I will snap at you before I turn back into human form, so... Not like bite you, just snap at you two.
How much are the topaz worth?
You're not really sure of a gold value on the topaz.
Okay.
Sentimental value.
Yeah. You may find that bartering is more effective than trying to get coinage. Okay. Based on your conversations with the Vistani, they don't tend to say that's worth so many gold. They'll barter, try to come to an arrangement. So the topaz are worth whatever you make them be worth.
Understood.
Alright, so we're still 4 miles out, right?
Well, 4 miles minus whatever you travel in a half an hour.
Oh, okay.
Well, since I'm low on hit points, while we're traveling, can I take a potion, or are we...
If you want to hang out in the wagons, you could easily get a short rest in before arriving at the gates.
I might do that, then.
That sounds like a plan.
Heal up some
and
of my
we
hit
can
points.
Spend hit die in a short rest.
Absolutely.
Up to 3, yeah. Like, you might want to spend more than just that one. Yeah.
You think?
That one's good. That's good.
I love how the roles are matching your characters, because, like, the only thing they're good at is the actual combat. For the role.
Right. That's true.
It's just... I love it. It's impressing me. Okay.
So I feel rested after sitting in that wagon myself.
Tarvik will be continuing to walk along the side of the wagons because the horses always get fairly nervous and spooked when he's around. They don't like him and he doesn't like them.
Can't imagine why. Right, and so you're all other than Charvik, you're all kind of sitting on the wagons.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Rookle climb back up to where he was.
No. And how much attention are you paying around you?
Zero.
Yeah, close to zero at this point. As
probably, yeah. I know. I'm sort of whatever does druids do? Meditate.
Groom.
Yeah, something.
Alright. Then it comes as pretty much a complete shock to you when someone...
This is something.
Oh, right.
Yeah, he's probably paying attention.
Oh, well, he does. Sorry, I didn't see that rule. Okay. Travik, you hear a rustling in the... hear and see movement off the rear right side flank of the caravan, just in the woods, but close enough you can tell you've been being followed.
Gotta determine if it's bipedal or quadruped. Just something out of the corner of my eye.
More something out of the corner of your eye at this point. It seems to be using the mists for cover. It's right at the edge of your visibility.
Okay. Without giving any, overt sign that he's noticed anything, like he's not going to run and scream or anything, he's just going to slow his pace until he's walking parallel to the wagon that Kelthris is resting on, and Chatterfick will mutter up to the wagon.
Hey, boss, there's something out there. It's been following us for a few minutes now. Can't quite make it out, though.
All right, everyone, stay alert. Kelthris will get out of the caravan and kind of walk slowly as the rest of the caravan is continuing to move forward so that eventually they'll move past him and we'll be at the back.
Alright. And the Vistani don't really slow down. You wonder if they've noticed and are trying to put you between them and whatever's out there, but they maintain a very steady pace. But if they get too far ahead, they'll stop for you.
Alright. We'll keep pace with them once we get towards the back. Or once I get towards the back, the rest of them. I'll ask them to accompany me, but whatever they wish to do, they'll do.
Everybody? Are you headed towards the back with the boss?
Sure, yeah, when I see him... hop down, I'll probably follow as well and start paying close attention to what's happening.
Chervik will keep pace with the middle of the caravan.
Already killed a wolf for you. And Rook will kick his feet up and give no indication that he has any interest in leaving where he is sitting.
Ponto will also, he'll continue to sit on the, but he'll look also at the other side to see if it maybe it's a distraction for something bigger.
Okay. After 5 or 10 minutes of essentially staring into blank mists, a large humanoid form emerges from the edge of the mist. It is very lupine, but very human, and it is some kind of hybrid human and wolf that you now encounter.
Friends to the back, Calphurus Jalens.
Oh, it's that close already.
Yeah, it's coming out of... Well, no, it's in this. Yeah, coming out of the mist, so it's probably more back to there. As far as what you guys are right here. But obviously, arrange yourselves to where you're... I just kind of dumped you guys on there and let you handle it.
I'm just putting Rookway over here, because I'm assuming he's back on the wagons, but not with, out of earshot.
Kelfers is standing front and center between the caravan and it. Is it steadily walking towards us, or did it stop as we stood our ground?
Oh no, it's making motions towards you. It's coming at you. It's
okay.
Been watching long enough, and it has decided that it has ready right. some food.
Oh yeah. Samson.
He is ready to go.
And I just wasted my 20.
Plenty of opportunity to run up and be the first victim.
Thanks, troops.
Thanks for your vote of confidence there.
And Ponto is the first to act.
Alright. Ooh, I can get it from here. Sweet. I am going to throw some radiant light at it.
Okay, that's
monks have it. Laser beams.
Oh.
Okay, one.
Okay, is that it?
Yes.
Okay, then he is still in bear form, because this has only been another, like, 45 minutes.
I thought I left bear form in an hour, and I thought it had been more than an hour.
Yeah, we did a short rest, that's an hour right there.
Oh, okay, yep, I forgot about the short rest. Okay, you're not a bear anymore. Hey, bye, bear.
We miss you. Is the werewolf considered a shapeshifter?
Yes.
Okay, let me see. I'll use my moonbeam on him.
Oh,
so he gets disadvantage on his saving throw, I think. Yes.
Alright, and that's a con save?
Yes. Oh, didn't even need that disadvantage.
You didn't. Wait. Are you using it, like, in his space?
Yes. Oh, yes. I'm sorry. Okay. Yes. Right there. Okay. Right on his space. On top of him.
Okay. Okay. Well, then he... Yeah, he's not happy with that at all.
You think a werewolf would like it?
Right.
Did it say did he fail?
Yeah, he failed.
It says a shapeshifter. If it fails, it also instantly reverts to its original form.
Oh wow!
Yeah. And can't assume a different form until it leaves the spell's light.
Yeah, that's the primary focus of the spell.
Yeah, you guys recognize a certain woodsman standing in the moonlight now.
Brian!
Shocker.
I knew this spell would come in handy.
Yeah. Well,
yeah.
And now the GM panics as they had to find stats for the regular person.
Right. Yeah. Sorry.
Thanks a lot. Give me 2 seconds. Ruining everything.
Expect the unexpected.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, but I mean, there's the unexpected, and then there's you guys.
There's unexpected screw-ups, and then there's our intentional ones.
Right, that's true, too.
You could always just wing it and, like, subtract 2 from everything.
No, I have... The worst part is that I have its human stats. I just didn't bother to enter them because it never occurred to me that I would be using them. Because I'm stupid.
It's just experience.
Yeah.
Plan never lasts after a first contact with the players.
Right. Okay. Well, a very angry Brian comes and he swings his silvered axe.
Oh, damn.
At Kaylin. Unfortunately, that's still the same.
Is this concentration?
My spell?
Yeah.
Let me look.
Doesn't really matter. It's already done to him what it needs to do.
Yeah, but he can change once he's out of the 5-foot.
Why did that do that?
Yes, as soon as he leaves the spell's light, he can change again if he wants. I don't know what...
Yeah, that particular spell leaves the moonbeam in that spot.
Yeah, I can choose to move it on my next turn as my action, so I can continue to move it to follow him, but it only affects him... Thank you, whoever put that there. It only affects him if he's in it. No!
Kitty.
Now they've come in here to bother me. that does miss.
Okay. Of curiosity, does anyone know why it's trying to give me 2 different damages? If I'd done something wrong with the...
Oh, the +2? So it's giving you the +2?
The 24 was the crit, yeah, so if you're...
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that +2 is that roll. Crit damage.
Yeah.
Gotcha. So, okay. The second one would be if it was crit. I kind of like that, now that I understand that I didn't enter anything wrong. Now, Brian has multi-attack.
No.
Everywhere will forever is going to be Brian from now on. That's going to be like headcanon. I'll be watching scary movies and they'll laugh. Anyways, he swings his axe again.
That misses.
Okay. Excellent. And Charvik.
Charvik will... Well, how far back... How long is this wagon chain, by the way? How many wagons are in it, do you think? Just a rough guess.
I'm sorry, what was that?
How many wagons are in the train, do you think? Just a rough guess.
5 or 6 wagons. It's not a huge caravan.
Okay, so I'll probably be running as fast as I can, panting slightly. I'm coming, boss! I'm coming! An extremely long range, a black bolt will streak through some of the leaves and foliage. It is a very long range, so that shouldn't be too much of an issue. But because of all the loose foliage and branches, it just strikes a branch and a small explosion happens, and you just see a branch fall to the ground, smoldering in black flames. Oops.
Fortunately, you're all pretty used to accidental explosions.
Save it for the show, Jarvik.
I'll get them next time, boss.
Alright.
How far away is the back wagon from this thing?
The back wagon would probably have gone around this bend and be somewhere down here.
Okay. So Rook will roll off the wagon he's on, and he will move here into the undergrowth. And he will toss his dagger at that thing. Will 25 hit?
Oh, yes.
And there's the regular damage, and he will add his sneak damage, and then I will use a bonus action to hide.
Yes, you are very successfully hidden.
Hey.
And Calthrus.
Okay, Calthrus is going to cast Fairy Fire on this thing. So with a violet light, the creature is surrounded. Does get to make a save, looks like. For Dex. That's a 14 he'll have to beat. Sweet.
He definitely does not make him save.
So anytime any of us try to attack him, we get advantage.
Wow, nice. Ever so mean. Alright, Ponto.
Yes, we're going to try this light strike again. Even with advantage, it probably misses.
It just barely hits with advantage.
Wow. I am awesome, you guys. I'm so good to surprise myself.
And Kaelin.
So I am going to move the moonbeam. So it's on top of him. And then do we want to assume it's still the 15 if he fails, or should I roll again?
I have no idea how that works.
Not either. It doesn't really say. It just says on each of your turns you can use an action to move this up to 60 feet.
Well, yeah, I kind of assume it's still the 15, right?
I would assume so, too, because it's the same
often
thing.
Often, anytime you reapply an effect, it's a second roll.
Oh, is it? Okay.
So, like, even if he had stepped out of the area and then stepped back into it, she would reroll?
I think so.
Okay, all right. Then
I will reroll.
All right, as will Brian.
Where did I go? Oh, there we go.
I second thought.
Well, you still have to, I mean, I guess roll your con save, because maybe yeah, you'll save.
He got the 16, so that would be okay. 9 damage?
Yep.
Are you still at disadvantage? Because the shapeshifter will throw a disadvantage.
That's right. Yep, so he did not get the save. Congratulations, Brian's dead. Brian falls to the ground.
Poor Brian.
I hope we meant to do that.
This is a silvered woodsman's axe falls at his feet as well.
Kelthrus will reach down and pick it up. Is there anything else on poor Brian?
No, poor Brian had nothing else except for his silver axe.
As Charvik runs up, boss, I made it. Is everything okay?
Just in time, Charvik.
Oh, who would think the woods would be so hard to run through?
Oh, thank Kaylin. She handled it for us.
I'll bow my head gently and say, you are welcome.
Yeah. Thanks.
So Brian wasn't lying. We do have to watch out for werewolves. Perhaps we should get to Barovia. Much speedier now.
Well, you can say this much. It never lacks for excitement.
Does Stanimir have any...
It has been an eventful evening.
Does Stanimir have anything to say about the werewolf? Was he surprised that we encountered one, or is this kind of commonplace for this area?
When you tell him that you have encountered this werewolf, he looks puzzled and concerned and shakes his head slowly and says, They have always roamed the woods, but never this close to the Svalich Road.
Just our luck, eh?
Hmm.
I'll shrug a little and say, maybe they are drawn to you.
We have set events in motion. Most assuredly so, they are after us. Let's continue on.
Rook's going to pull Kel aside for a moment, as the rest of the party says, and he's going to say in a hushed tone, he's like, you know this is a setup, right?
And explain how you know this.
Those sneaky gypsies set us up for this. Do you think all the spooky mist and us finding that note and moving through here is all coincidence?
Regardless of their true purpose, I feel that we are drawn to this mission.
Drawn or not, I'm still only doing it for the money.
How with the money I'm sure you will have.
I get that the rest of you all have this whole high and mighty path you're trying to walk here and trying to do the right thing, and I can respect that, but understand, I'm just a burglar.
I can't say that I'm doing it for much better reasons.
Well, just as long as we understand each other, all right?
As always, Rook. I understand your motivations.
He's going to nod and continue towards the wagons.
But perhaps you could be a little quicker on saving us. Next time, of course. He'll wink and go back to the caravan.
Hey, boss, you think we'll encounter any more critters out here? I have to say, I've been having a lot of fun out here. Don't usually get to let loose like this.
It's testing us, but we seem to be doing quite well. I'm having a bit of fun myself.
Excellent. I knew I followed you around for a reason.
Continue towards Barovia.
Alright. Well, this is Donnie. Kind of tighten up the wagons and are more alert as they continue forth, but it's a relatively uneventful remainder of the trip before the fog spills out of the forest to swallow up the road behind you. Ahead, jutting from the impenetrable woods on both sides of the road, are high stone buttresses looming gray in the fog. Huge iron gates hang on the stonework. Dew clings with cold tenacity to the rusted bars. Two headless statues of armed guards flank the gate, their heads now lying among the weeds at their feet. They greet you only with silence.
Statues, you said?
Yes. Headless statues of armed guardians on either side of the gate.
Such a lovely place.
Yeah, that's quite an odd greeting. Let's inspect the statues, see if there's anything of note.
I was going to ask, because I feel like this would give me the heebie-jeebies a little bit.
Okay, yeah, go ahead and roll for however you're, whether you're using Investigation or Arcana, whatever your preference for how you would search is, or how you would check them out is. Okay, there's nothing arcane about them at all, Kaelin. As for the rest of you, they are of a particularly, old style, but you don't see anything, unique about them, just that they're very ancient and very unusual. But they seem, for all the world, like regular old statues.
Just creepy old statues.
Indeed.
Yo, Standomir, what are those about?
He will shrug his shoulders a little and say, "The gates to the land of Barovia proper."
Right, yeah, but who are those folks? What did they do to get statues made of them?
He'll laugh a little and say, "Oh, they are no one in particular. In years past, Barovia was grand and had many enemies, and its royal family wished to impress upon those who entered that they did, those who sought to enter, that they did not wish to be enemies with Barovia." Now, with very little traffic in and no traffic out, save my Vistani, they serve only as a reminder of what once was.
Right, well, I do not know about you, but if we're not close to the town, I think I hear the tavern calling in a glass of, in a large flagon of ale with my name on it.
Agreed. I'd like to be stationary for a while and enjoy a drink. So we'll step through the gates and continue?
I think so.
Yeah, let's do it. I'm certainly ready to sit down for a bit or not be traveling.
There's so much to learn about our new place.
That is true as well.
The only thing I want to learn about right now is a nice, comfortable chair by the fireplace, and I put my feet up. You're not the ones who've been walking this whole way.
Get settled. We'll be here forever.
One might say for the rest
of our
lives.
Oh, you're not joking. That's right, you're not joking.
Hold on a second.
Does that mean Rook dropped one of his browned gems?
What were you trying to sleight of handing?
The world we might never know.
As you guys go to go through the gates, Stanimir's daughter drags Rook forward and says to Kalthus, "You might want to do something about the thief in your midst."
Oh no, you got caught.
Gareth, what would you do now, you stupid little thing?
Has he stolen your heart, miss?
Oh, that was
bad. Pulled her arm.
And he's going to look all innocent and say, "I don't know what she's talking about."
Pulled her arms angrily and say, "He only wishes." And she'll show another little sack of gems and he was trying to steal from my father after we so generously paid you for those wolf pelts.
Oh, we're terribly sorry. You see, our friend here has a bit of a condition.
I'll say.
He cannot keep his hands to himself.
I consider that payment for services rendered.
Rook, we shall make restitution. As he taps his foot and looks at Rook and then to his pouch.
Fine. But next time... Well, just next time.
Next time you'll try not to get caught so easily.
She'll lift her hand and say, "No restitution, just keep an eye on him the rest of the way to Madame Eva. Understood?"
Of course, m'lady.
First time this happens, he's your problem. The second time, he will be ours.
Oh, I'm afraid he'll be our problem for quite a long time as well.
She'll laugh at that, appreciate the sort of humorous response, and nod and go back to the group.
As soon as they turn their backs, he's going to flip both of them off and spit.
Many, many riches. He brings out the letter again and points at it and lets Rook read it.
Right, but I'd much rather have their riches. Not sticking my neck out for the like of them again.
Perhaps we'll need to find some easier prey for you going forward. These are a bit out of our league.
Well, about that, I was chatting up those ladies I was riding with on the way here. As turns out, most of the folks in this village are poor.
Because it's concentrated wealth. That's how the nobility works. Believe me, I know.
Here's the thing, though. They're a superstitious lot, so I'm thinking we can take advantage of the gentry.
So you're saying put the people down on their luck, even more down on their luck?
Well, not the people, mind you, but, you know, the lords up top, the ones that got the coin. Ones that ain't going to miss a little bit if we cut it away. But, you know, I'm thinking more like a sham sort of thing here. So maybe we can play up this vampire thing or some sort, you know, offer to rid them of the creature. Because, you know, I'm thinking maybe there's not really a creature.
Exactly, Rook. Think of your best strategy for that. We'll see how that works out. I'll back that plan 100%.
All right. So you follow my lead, then?
Indeed. Let's see what you have.
Trevik just raises an eyebrow at Kelthris, wondering what his boss is up to.
Rook's going to nod and seem very pleased with himself over this small victory.
He winks at Trevik.
Earning him a toothy grin. Right. Oh, that's my boss, all right. Oh, he's got some plan going.
Okay, as the caravan moves toward the gates open to allow them pass, sort of seemingly on their own, you continue through with the caravan?
Absolutely.
The gates, shortly after the last wagon has gone through, jump closed behind you with a dull thread sound. And moving forward, you see tall shapes loom out of the dense fog that surrounds everything. The muddy ground underfoot gives way to slick, wet cobblestone. The tall shapes gradually become recognizable as village dwellings. The windows of each house stare out from pools of blackness. No sound cuts the silence, except from mournful sobbing that echoes through the streets from a distance. The Vistani stop their wagons just outside of town, and they nod and say, "The road goes straight through. We have no business in town. We'll be continuing. Will you be stopping in town?"
"At the closest inn with a flagon of ale, aye."
"We will. Will you meet us with Madame Eva when we are completed?"
Scandamir will nod and say, "You can come to our encampment. Continue on this road, and when it branches, head north. You will come to the encampment where Madame Eva makes her home, and we will make introductions there."
"Very good."
Then he and the rest of his group continue forward and leave you in the village of Barovia.
All right.
You said we passed through gates.
Yes.
Who opened the gates?
They opened on their own.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I thought they were open already. Did they actually move open as we were passing by?
That's even creepier.
Yes. They opened for the first wagon and then thudded closed behind the last wagon.
How do you think they figured out that trick with the gates?
I don't know, but I'm really starting to like these people. They have some really great effects.
That is definitely one way to look at the situation.
Sounds like a question to be asked among the tavern folk.
Okay.
How far away of a walk is it to town?
From the gates to the town, it's not a very long walk at all. Stanimir will walk with you pretty much to the town, and then he will continue straight through. So you're able to get from the gates to the town in maybe 20-30 minutes at most if you're moseying. Maybe 10 if you're moving at a regular pace.
And what's the terrain like around us? Or is it still woods and fog?
It's woods and fog on the edges of the road. And as you reach the village, you'll notice that the mist is not thick. It doesn't set in on the village the way that it does on the woods.
Well, at least we're leaving that bloody fog behind.
Oh, it's not foggy here?
Not within the village. Nice. It has receded more now that you're inside the gates. You're in the realm of Barovia proper. But it's still, like, at the edge of your view. You're still surrounded by it, and you know that, but it's not as closer as threatening. You don't feel like it's hurting you the direction it wants you to go quite so much anymore.
Can we see a crisp outline of the sun?
No, it is completely overcast and just dull clouds, even though it's mid-afternoon.
Oh, finally, we're out of that mist. Now maybe my bedroll will actually dry out. Been playing havoc with my hair, I'll tell you that.
Alright, is it hard to find the tavern?
It is not. As you continue through the road through town, you come to a square, and off this square, there's a large building you can see that could only possibly be a tavern.
Are there people milling about and such? You said there was some wailing, like, sobbing or something.
There's every so often, you hear a sobbing echo through the town across the cobblestones. You'd have to kind of seek it out if you wanted to find out what that's about, but there's not a lot of people. You pass the occasional person, but certainly nothing to what you would expect a small village to have in the middle of the afternoon.
Do they seem cheery?
No. You have never seen a more dour people in your entire lifetime.
And how do they react to us coming through?
You get a few stares, most especially Charvik. But then they seem to sort of look back away and hurry on their way.
Not a very joyous lot, are they?
What I've heard, they have reason not to be.
Well, let's find this tavern. I need a pint.
Ah, finally, something we can agree on.
Right to that square.
Alright. A single shaft of light. Oh, go ahead.
I think I'm actually really interested in that, in the sobbing sounds. Is there a way that I can, I mean, I'm sure my party might, I'm sure my party won't mind if I maybe slip off, but is there a way I can hunt that down and
figure it out? Yeah, you can roll some perception to see if you can tell what direction that's coming from. Okay, so when the party arrive at the main square, and are looking to head northward towards the tavern, which is at the very north of the main square. You're pretty sure that sound is coming from due south, from the little road there.
So I'm going to say to them, I'm not interested in a drink. I'm more curious, about that sobbing. I wonder if they might know anything or can share any information with us. So I think I'm going to go investigate that if anybody's interested in joining me.
I will come and join you.
You go do that. I'm going to go get the beer.
I think we shouldn't really be on our own in such a strange place, so yet.
Yes, if you come upon anything, come at once to the tavern.
Certainly we will. We won't. We'll try not to get into too much trouble without you.
Okay. So are we going to go to the tavern or to the sound first, guys? Which do you want to address?
Do the sound first, if you like.
All right. So you guys head down that south road that you found, Kaylin?
Yeah. Yes.
All right.
I imagine we're maybe doing it stealthily. Maybe trying to... quietly as not to...
As a bear, scare. Right?
Yeah, right, as a bear, yes. Don't want to scare the sobbing individual.
So less so just... trying to hide and more so kind of trying to blend in?
Yes, exactly.
Okay, gotcha. Stealth works.
Oh my, so roll a stealth?
Yeah. I can't think of what else to use, so we'll go with That's stealth. Fine. Again, not to be unseen, but more to be less noticeable.
Right, we're not going to sneak up and kill them or anything, it's just...
Right, just be, look like a normal townsperson, or like more part of what they would expect. Okay.
Try to blend in with the surroundings, with the people, not with this. Yeah.
Right. So you're a Barovian, not a Barovian building.
Right, exactly.
Gotcha. Okay, so...
I'm a building, don't look this way. I'm a lamppost now.
There's nothing here. I'm a barber pole. Yeah. Sorry. You walk down a couple, past a couple buildings, and find yourself hearing a moaning sob float through the still gray streets, coloring your thoughts with sadness. The sounds obviously flow from a dark two-story townhouse.
I'll turn to Ponto and ask, should we get closer? Should we not?
Well, I was going to say, what time of day is it?
That's a good question.
It's mid-afternoon, like 2 to 4 o'clock.
Well, I'd say at that point, then, yeah, we would knock. Exactly what our introduction is, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I don't... if we hang out, can we hear anything else, or is it just sobbing? Do we hear any dialogue of any sort?
You can't hear anything else in particular coming from the building, and it is completely dark.
Yep.
Okay, well then I will approach the door and knock.
Yeah.
I'll be bold.
And there is no response.
Oof.
The sobbing continues intermittently. The house remains dark.
Is there a back building? Or is this actually coming from the house?
No, this is definitely coming from the house.
Try knocking again, and then...
Yeah.
if we don't get a response, then take note of the house. Is this the only one that's actually making noise?
Yes, this is definitely where the only place where the sobbing is coming from. And when you knock again, there is similarly no response.
As we walked up to the house, was there anybody out in the streets?
No.
Okay.
You almost feel like maybe the villagers kind of avoid this area as well.
Okay, well, oof. Well, maybe, okay, I'm gonna shout up to the window and say, hey, is everything okay up there?
The sobbing quiets for a moment, and then continues again.
There's definitely a spirit here, but maybe a little chat with the locals might explain all this.
That's what I was going to suggest. Let's head back to the tavern where our party is, and maybe we'll run into some locals and we can ask about this.
Is this house run down at all, or is it maintained? To Barovia standards, yes.
Yeah, it's pretty much par for the course. There isn't really any place that's not run down. But it's not any more run down than the houses on either side of it.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah, yeah, I sort of think maybe we should just ask around.
Yeah, maybe we should head back and see what others can tell us.
Yeah.
All right.
So that was an exciting adventure.
Meanwhile, back at the inn. The three of you gentlemen were headed toward the tavern, right?
Yeah, I'm trying to keep Rook from getting arrested, if I can.
Alright. When you arrive at the town square, a single shaft of light thrusts illumination into the main square, its brightness looking like a solid pillar in in the overcast day. Above the gaping doorway, a sign hangs precariously askew, proclaiming this to be the Blood on the Vine Tavern.
Don't care much for the name.
I think it's got some interesting flavor.
Does it sound busy from the outside? Is there music playing or people being loud?
Are there sobs coming from the tavern?
There are no sobs coming from the tavern, nor is there music. But you can hear conversation within. Animated conversation.
Alright, let's go inside.
Alright. A blazing fire in the hearth warms those within. There are not many patrons. Most are of the common drab folk that you have seen on the streets as you have entered Barovia. The exceptions being the barkeep, three people that you recognize as Vistani, all sitting together in one corner, and a man in fairly noble garb sitting near the hearth.
Making a bit of an entrance, Charvik kind of lets the door bang as against the wall as they enter the tavern. And he just calls out to the the bartender, or if there's a serving girl or anything like that. He's like, good evening. Can I get 3 ales over here? We'll be over by the hearth. And just plops himself down in the first seat closest to the fiery hearth. Uh-huh. Probably a little closer than most would find comfortable.
The pudgy, short barkeep nods his head and sort of mindlessly pours the ales and sets them on the counter for you.
Kalthras looks over the crowd, and he looks for anyone that's trying to make eye contact with him. He's going to engage in a stare down, if need be.
You see the three Vistani in the corner glancing at you periodically, and they're not overtly inspecting you, but you can tell that you're the subject of some speculation. But the man by the hearth, the young man by the hearth, is very much interested and curious, giving you, you know, eyeing you with interest and curiosity, rather.
Rook will scoop up his ale and follow Char over toward the table. He's also going to size up the crowd, but he's looking for people that look of higher birth or more wealth than your common peasant folk.
Well, other than the Vistani and the young nobleman, there's really not anybody. A couple of the commoners might be more nicely appointed than the others, but by Barovian standards, so that's still not really up to Rook's standards.
Got it. But the guy by the fires appears to be a nobleman.
Yes, okay. He's nicely dressed, and he has a way of carriage that suggests that he is of higher birth.
Got it.
Jeremy will finding a seat next to the hearth with ale in hand. He's going to kick his boots off and prop his feet up directly on the hearth. Potentially even in the fire to relax his aching feet, and he's just going to look over to the noble that's scrutinizing him and give him a quirked eyebrow and a steely metallic grin.
What's with you? You never seen a guy relax before?
The young man will actually return Charvik's grin, which, now that you think of it, is the first any kind of smile you've seen since entering the mist several days ago. He'll give a chuckle and say, "Certainly not like that." And he'll reach out a hand and introduce himself. Hey, Ismar Koyanovich. Well met.
You mind if I call you Ivan?
And he's gonna tilt his head a little and say, "If you wish. Oh, you know Ivan is not my name."
It suits you anyway. Nice to meet you, Ivan. I'm Cervik.
He'll laugh a little and say, "Mind if I call you Peter?"
Yeah, you can call me Susan if you like.
What did he say his name was?
Ismar Koyanovich.
Ismar.
Oh, I actually can't pronounce that. I'll
try to. Hey, boss, you should go meet this guy.
Yeah, Kethris will step over.
You'll have to forgive my friend. He doesn't, they don't teach him manners where he comes from. And, Rook's going to kind of kick his feet out of the fire.
What is wrong with you? That's very rude of you.
You've got to show this proper respect. And he's going to bow to, not a deep bow, but kind of a gracious bow to Ismark and say, "Pardon him, my lord. We're but traveling performers. Just seeking a warm hearth and a bit of bitter beer."
Ismark will kind of incline his head and say, "There's no need for milords here in the tavern, and Besides, I am not the nobility, that's my father.
All the same, you're too kind, sir.
It's a pleasure to meet you, Mr. Kulianovich. I'm Keldris. I'm inquisitive about your last name. It seems rather familiar. Would you happen to know an Irina?
And he goes from kind of smiling and trying to have a good time to deathly serious and says, Irina is my sister. And he'll suddenly seem suspicious of you and say, how do you know of her?
He'll quickly take out the parchment that he retrieved from the unfortunate messenger. And he'll say, we saw a poor man dead on the side of the road, and he was carrying this. Do you know anything about this?
He'll skin it, shake his head and say, my father dispatched Daniel to put this at the edge of the mists in hopes that no traveler such as yourself would find yourselves trapped here. And he's gonna just look completely weary and defeated.
No need to be defeated, sir. We're here to solve these problems. Hold that. Kind of smirk at that.
He'll sort of glance from the others to Keldris and say, do you think a performance troupe is what we need?
Certainly liven your spirits, would it not?
He'll chuckle ever so slightly and say, perhaps.
So, your father, you say, and where might he be? And if you don't know, and if it doesn't matter, I can rephrase the question.
Yeah, I'm not sure at the moment, so can you rephrase that differently?
Yeah,
I didn't
absolutely
expect to get to this conversation yet tonight, so.
All good.
Sorry.
Let's say that my actual question was, how can we help you?
Oh. He's going to kind of gesture to the missive that Kalfas had and say, unless you think you could help me move my sister outside the reach of the Devil's Strahd, then I'm not sure what help you can do for me.
Well, the fates have aligned us, and you are fortunate enough to be in our good graces. We are here to help you with this plight.
That is to say, if you've got the proper coinage, if you catch my drift.
He's gonna laugh a little and say, there it is, there it is. Yes, I suppose I could come up with something, but how am I to know that you have even the skills to help me with what I need?
Well, are you saying you can't take a bloke on the name of his word?
Or the axe of a fallen werewolf?
With that, he'll raise his eyebrows.
We are no strangers to battle, although we do put on a rather good show.
It's all part of the fun. You got to do things with certain flair.
He kind of nods slowly and
Chirvy just snaps his fingers as a bright spark appears on his callous hand.
We are traveling with the Vistani. We're on our way to see Madame Eva. If there's anything that you could add that would help us in our mission would be appreciated.
He's gonna kind of slowly shake his head and say, well, it does seem that our courses run in the same direction. I would like to take my sister Irina to another village that is outside the shadow of the castle of the vampire that's been after her these few nights. I do not wish to see her reduced to nothing more than one of them. Perhaps we might travel together, at least until you meet your destination. And you could help me keep my sister safe while she's still in the shadow of the castle.
We will definitely keep your sister safe, as he makes a glance over to Rook, won't we?
Sure. So if I catch your drift right, you know a way out of this mist?
He's going to kind of stare at him and say, of the mists? Absolutely not. But the further from the castle, I believe that... And he'll kind of glance up and say that its ruler will have less pull, less power.
Do you know who this ruler is?
Well, he's going to kind of nod and say, once was a man named Strahd. He was a prince. He took this land, conquered it, named it after his father, named the castle after his mother. There are many stories as to how he became what he is. But all I know is that he's taken a liking to my sister, and I cannot let him, will not let him have her.
Hey, didn't those gypsy folks mention something about a prince? Wasn't that part of the tale they told us to lure us, into this mess in the first place?
I believe you are correct.
See, I told you this was a setup.
Well, setup or not, if it plays well, it plays well. Work is work.
Well, I can't argue with that.
Besides, what else are we going to get a chance to have so much fun?
Well, it seems we've taken on yet another task, so rest while we can.
Ismark will nod and he'll tell you, my father's mansion is at the end of the road to the south. When you have rested tomorrow, if you would come, we can make arrangements.
Oracle nod and quickly down the rest of his drink.
Alright. I guess we'll just hang out here for a while and see if anything else seems amiss. And then afterwards, we'll debate whether we go to Madame Eva or stay the night and go to the house.
However, since it is 10 minutes to 11, it probably makes the most sense to stop here and make that decision next week.
Absolutely.
Cool. And next week we'll probably wrap up the village since there's not a whole lot here. So.
I'm sure Rook can find some people to steal from.
Right. Alright.
Cool. Well, fun session. Thanks,
yeah.
Guys.
Yeah.
Thank you guys so very much.
No problem. Doing good.
Mm-hmm.
indeed.
Indeed.
It's all that matters, right?
See you guys next week.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, thanks, Meg.
Good night, all.
Thanks, guys. Yeah. Night.
Take care.
Night. Good night.